Good evening, everybody. Merry Christmas, almost. Lovely to see you all here tonight. And we have a couple of changes. We're not going to have our special anthem for that we were going to do during communion tonight. Just didn't work out. So we're just going to, communion is going to be straight through. There's not going to be any solo in the middle of it, or a duet as we were hoping for. When it comes time to lighting the candles for Silent Night, the ministers will come down the aisle with candles, and you can just pass a light on to each other like we've done in the past. I don't think that would make any problems for anybody. Also, we're going to do cares and joys and concerns right now so that we can write them down so Lori can work them into the prayers of the people. So obviously the big joy is it's Christmas, and we've had a minister in the past that has said, it's Christmas Eve, whatever you've gotten, haven't gotten done yet, it's okay, relax. it's time to chill out and to celebrate the birth of our Lord. Are there specific joys anybody wants to lift up today?
I spoke to Andrea today.
Excellent.
Yeah.
Andrea White?
Yes. Good. She's in a it was hard to understand her. She's very weak. She's in a regular room and she's waiting for a room at Alec.
Okay.
She said to say that.
Here. Which hospital is she in right now?
Dyson.
CMC.
I can give you the room number actually.
All right. Thank you. Are there other joys? Are there concerns that we want to lift up? There's one concern that I've been mentioned is that we were supposed to have the memorial list printed in today's bulletin, and my printer program that I used to print it out decided to freeze up on me. So I will have it for Sunday, but I don't have it for tonight. Are there specific prayer concerns that anybody would like to lift up tonight?
Yeah.
After 40 years in ministry, one of the things I've discovered when you have passed the candles, the unlit candle should be the one that is, you know, turned, because if you turn the lit candle, you're going to get hot wax on your hands. And that doesn't feel very good. So that's just a little reminder. Okay.
And one thing that I forgot to do is to welcome, we have a duo of pastors tonight. And that is the Reverend Bill Samford, honorably retired, who has agreed to do to lead us in worship on Christmas Eve. And of course, we have our commission pastor, Lori Lockney. So, hey, we got two power plays tonight. Hearing no other joys or concerns, let us focus our minds and hearts on the worship of God as we anticipate the birth of our Lord and Savior with our prelude.
Thank you. child cries out, a new life begins. Hope is born, and life shines forth for all to see.
A child is born, rejoice and sing.
The Prince of Peace is in our midst. Christ is born, rejoice and sing. Hallelujah. Amen. Let's stand and sing our first carol. How's that?
Say together the Christmas Eve prayer in unison. Let us pray. Wonderful Counselor, mighty God, be born in our hearts this night. Shine your light into the darkness of our world, that all the earth might know your glorious presence, and that all people might find hope in your love and grace. In your glorious name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. For our first lesson, God declares in the Garden of Eden that the seed of woman shall bruise the serpent's head. They heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden at the time of the evening breeze, and the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord God called to the man and said to him, "Where are you?" And the man said, "I heard the sound of you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, and I hid myself." God said, "Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree of which I commanded you not to eat?" The man said, "The woman whom you gave to be with me, she gave me the fruit from the tree, and I ate." Then the Lord God said to the woman, "What is this that you have done?" The woman said, "The serpent tricked me, and I ate." The Lord God said to the serpent, "Because you have done this, cursed are you among all animals and among all wild creatures. Upon your belly you shall go, and dust you shall eat all the days of your life. I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. He will strike your head, and you will strike his heel." Remain seated for our singing of the hymn.
The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. You have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with the joy of the harvest, as people exult when dividing plunder. For the yoke of their burden and the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor, you have broken as on the day of Midian. For all the boots of the tramping warriors and all the garments rolled in blood shall be burned as fuel for the fire. For a child has been born for us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulders. He is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His authority shall grow continually, and there shall be endless peace for the throne of David and his kingdom. He will establish and uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time onward and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. And we'll remain seated for our carol.
The angel Gabriel salutes the Blessed Virgin. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, and to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. And the virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her and said, "Greetings, favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was much perplexed by his words and wondered what sort of greeting this might be. And the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give to him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." Then Mary said, "Here am I, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." Then the angel departed from her. Thank you.
Matthew and Luke tell of the birth of Jesus. Now, the birth of Jesus, the Messiah, took place this way. When his mother Mary had been engaged to Joseph, but before they lived together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. Her husband Joseph, being a righteous man and unwilling to expose her to public disgrace, planned to dismiss her quietly. But just when he had resolved to do this, the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you are to name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what had been spoken by the Lord through the prophet. "Look, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall name him Emmanuel, which means God is with us." When Joseph awoke from sleep, he did what the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took her as his wife, but had no marital relations with her until she had borne a son, and he named him Jesus. In those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their hometowns to be registered. Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child, and she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn. Please remain seated for the singing of our hymn, "Away in a Manger."
Shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flocks by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find the child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." Then suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom he favors." And when the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." And so they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told to them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen, as it had been told to them. Shall we remain seated?
I think we need to stand up for this.
Let's stand for Go Tell It on the Mountain.
John unfolds the great mystery of the incarnation. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came to being through him, and without him, not one thing came into being. What came into being in him was life. And the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. And the Word became flesh and lived among us. And we have seen his glory, the glory of a Father's only Son, full of grace and truth.
The setting of this carol is called Divinum Mysterium, and it is done in plain song version, almost like a chant. Of the Father's love begotten, ere the worlds began to be, He is Alpha and Omega, He the source, the ending, He. Of the things that are, that have been, and that future year shall see, evermore and evermore. Now this is He whom sins seers in old time chanted of with one accord, whom the voices of the prophets promised in their faithful word. Now He shines, the long expected. Let creation praise its Lord evermore and evermore. Christ to thee with God the Father and O Holy Ghost to thee, Him enchant and high thanksgiving and unwearied praises be. Honor, glory, and dominion and eternal victory evermore and evermore. Amen.
Thank you, Tim. Paul explains the significance of the birth of Jesus. For the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation to all, training us to renounce impiety and worldly passions, and in the present age to live lives that are self-controlled, upright, and godly. While we wait for the blessed hope and the manifestation of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, He it is who gave Himself for us, that He might redeem us from all iniquity and purify for Himself a people of His own who are zealous for good deeds. We got to stand for this next hymn. This is, you have to. So we will stand for the next hymn.
Thank you.
Let us all pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Well, we're here to celebrate a birthday. Maybe we should be singing happy birthday. I don't know. But not just any birthday. This is the birthday of our Lord, Jesus Christ. But quite frankly, I think we have a problem. And that is, we've heard this story year after year, and we think we know it. Maybe we don't know all of it, but we think we know most of it. And therefore, I wonder if we really understand the miracle that it really is. Now, if God, the creator of all there is, decided to come to earth as one of us, wouldn't we expect that Almighty God would be born in some spectacular palace in a great capital city to prominent parents? But instead, God turns our expectations on their heads, and God comes to us as a baby born to a poor young couple in a manger, in a stable, located in a tiny village in a country far from the seat of power. What's going on here? And more importantly, why would the creator of the universe come here as one of us to begin with? Here's a Christmas story that might help explain. One day, all of the angels were gathered about the heavenly throne for a discussion. Things were a mess down on earth. Well, what else is new, right? The Creator had become terribly concerned about the state of the creation. Wars, fighting, hate, pandemics, famine, bloodshed, all over the place. I've tried everything, God complained. I've spoken with them with some of the most beautiful words that they could ever hope to hear. Think of the glorious psalms, the hymns, the poetic passages from Isaiah. Oh, they love to read about peace and goodwill, but they sure don't live it. God continued, I even sent them prophets, prophets like Isaiah. Now, they love Isaiah, the promise of release from their sufferings, freedom from their exile. But do they follow the precepts of the prophets about justice and righteousness rolling down like waters? Nope, never. Now, there was a widespread discussion of the sad state of affairs on earth. Some of the angels, Gabriel and Michael and others, had been to earth on several occasions. They had seen for themselves the sources of God's lament, and shared God's concern. Then God said, well, I think the only thing left is for one of you, a member of the heavenly court, to go down to earth and live with them, not just for a moment, but every day. Get to know them, become one of them. Let them get to know you. Only then will heaven be truly communicated to them. Only then will they take notice of the great gap between the way they've been living and the way they were created. Only then will we be able to reveal to them who I created them to be. Well, the angels stuck around looking very awkward. You know, oh, I hope he doesn't call on me. Oh, you know, please, please don't call on me. Anyway, They've been to Earth before. Oh, yes. To deliver messages from God, to affect some momentary intervention in human affairs. They were not about to volunteer for long-term duty in such a dangerous and difficult place like Earth. Well, the silence lasted for what seemed to be an eternity. Finally, God himself broke the silence, quietly, determinedly, but without any sense of resignation and no bitterness, God said, "Then I will go." And so we celebrate God's coming to us on Christmas Eve. Emmanuel, God with us. But I suspect that many of us may wonder how we can celebrate with all that's happening in the world around us. Well, I came across this story the other day about the song, "I Heard the Bells on Christmas Day." And it spoke to me, and I hope it speaks to you about the importance of not giving up hope, that God is with us and God's will prevail. Peace on earth is a familiar greeting on Christmas cards. This one this year that might be more heartfelt than ever, and yet for some, even harder to believe. Peace on earth seems distant in these last weeks and months as sorrow and disbelief have burdened us all. It may help to know that the poet Henry Wadsworth Longfellow shared a similar sense of disillusionment as he penned the words of his famous carol, "I Heard the Bells on Christmas Day," in the midst of the horrors of the Civil War. He began to write, "I heard the bells on Christmas Day, their old familiar carols play, and wild and sweet the words repeat of peace on earth, goodwill to men. And in despair, I bowed my head. There is no peace on earth, I said, for hate is strong and mocks the sound of peace on earth, goodwill to men." How could one believe in peace in a world filled with unimaginable hope and despair? That might be a question for all of us to think about tonight. But Longfellow dug deep into a faith that, as we read in the letter to the Hebrews, is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. And concluded with the words of that famous, that comfort us still, in his last verse, and he writes this: "Then pealed the bells more loud and deep. God is not dead, nor doth he sleep. The wrong shall fail, the right prevail, with peace on earth, goodwill to all." Well, that said, but still maybe some of you are still not quite convinced. Maybe you aren't feeling worthy enough, or well enough, or safe enough, or happy enough to be able to receive this good news. Maybe you are still in the wilderness. Here is the good news. Even in the wilderness, even to someone like me and you, the good news of life, love, hope, peace, and joy comes to us. Anne Reams puts it beautifully when she writes this: "Not celebrate. Your burden is too great to bear. Your loneliness is intensified during this Christmas season. Your tears seem to have no end. Not celebrate. You should lead the celebration. You should run through the streets and peal the bells and sing the loudest. You should fling the tinsel on the tree and open your house to your neighbors and call them to dance. For it is to you, above all others, who know the joy of Christmas. It is unto you that a Savior is born this night, one who comes to lift your burdens from your shoulders, who comes to wipe the tears from your eyes. You are not alone, for he is born this day for you. My friends, God has caused a baby, God himself, to be born, to turn the world upside down. God takes sides. God is on the side of the lonely, the weak, the hungry, the sick, those who despair, those who have a hard time celebrating this year. God has come to fill the hungry with good things, to discover sight, to recover sight to the blind, to heal the brokenhearted. God has done great things and will continue to do great things. God has come to turn the world upside down. Holy is God's name, Emmanuel, God with us. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Joy to the world, the Lord has come. Thanks be to God. Amen. And we have to stand for this hymn. So let us stand and sing Joy to the World.
Thank you.
illuminated in your peace.
Thank you. life-giving word and Holy Spirit, that we may be nourished and strengthened through this supper. Grant that all who share the communion of the body and blood of your Son may be united in him, and we may remain faithful in love and hope until we feast joyfully with him in his eternal kingdom. On this night, we remember that though the world is ruled by governments, your story reveals that you are the only true sovereign and your reign is everlasting. Thank you that justice and righteousness are in your hands. We praise you for the peace that you have promised and made manifest in your Son, Jesus Christ. We pray for all of the leaders of government. We grant them wisdom in their decisions, with a will for the common good and the courage to work with their colleagues for ways that bring peace, health, and safety to all people. Shine on them and give them peace. We pray for those who, like the shepherds, are working tonight and keeping watch over those in hospital beds and other places who serve the public, who serve our country here and around the world. Shine upon them. We pray for our church family, for our members and friends and the congregation gathered here. We are grateful for the joy of gathering together and celebrating the birth of Jesus. We are grateful for the small joys, the peace that comes to us when we realize that in spite of things left undone, that you are born and we are rejoicing no matter what, in spite of everything. We pray for those who face the holidays with sadness, with illness, with worries about what will happen next. Shine upon them and give them peace. We pray especially for Stephanie and Andrea and are grateful that they are recovering and on the mend. But we pray for your continued peace and comfort for them and healing. We pray for all that are on our minds tonight. We boldly pray for your intercessions in the name of your Son, Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thank you.
You may be seated.
We are not alone walking in darkness.
Light has dawned, and the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation to us all.
As the Prince of Peace has blessed us with the light of grace,
we invite you to bless one another as we pass the light of the Christ King.
Thank you.
deep peace of the running wave to you. Deep peace of the flowing air to you. Deep peace of the quiet earth to you. Deep peace of the shining stars to you. Deep peace of the watching shepherds to you. Deep peace of Christ, the light of the world, to you. Merry Christmas, everyone.
Merry Christmas.